all youth, tear apart the core of blasphemy. Follow your prophet, and on evil make a victory. Let our righteousness be a role model to our children, making new generations of believers decently upbringing, with parents as an example. As gems we shape them, fearing only Allah, devoting our lives for Him.
Bismillah, assalamu alaikum, peace. Welcome to Closing the Gap. I'm your host, Omar Dunlap. We have with us, of course, Sheikh Yusuf Estes. Welcome.
Assalamu alaikum, Omar.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. Today, Sheikh, it seems like it might be pertinent to discuss the gap between belief and unbelief. So, could you elaborate on that topic for us?
Belief and unbelief. Do you mean in reference to like religions, or you mean just like in general to believe something or not believe something?
We'll say we could tackle both. Why not? You know, in general to believe, to not believe, but in particular when it comes to religion.
Well, in this case, we might take as an example the creationists versus the Darwinists, if you will, those who are atheists. They don't choose to believe in a God. They are atheists. Now, a theist is one who has this belief in a deity. And an atheist is without. If we put A in front of something, it becomes without. For instance, moral. Someone who has morals is a very moral person. And if they're doing things against this, they would be immoral. But if they don't have any morals whatsoever, either way, they are amoral. Okay, so an atheist is one without a belief. Theist is with a belief.
That's probably well. So if we're talking about evolutionism, maybe we could discuss exactly what is evolution and creationism and that sort of thing.
According to the evolutionists themselves, evolution is in theory. That's why it's called the theory of evolution. When a species evolves from one species to another, to another, to another. For instance, a fish over a period of time and conditions can evolve to become a type of reptile, or the reptile could evolve to be some type of insect, or the insect could evolve to become some type of bird, a flying thing, etc. And in some cases, there is evidence that something like this has occurred in nature. And then in other cases, there's some pretty far-fetched ideas that, well, even for a fifth grader, they wouldn't work out too good.
And what about belief? What exactly does that entail?
To believe in something implies belief without a substantial fact. Because if you have a fact, and you believe in a fact, that's just common knowledge. Okay? So when they talk about beliefs, what they mean is somebody who's willing to believe something without actually having an evidence for it. If you believe something happened, although you weren't there, you would be taking somebody's testimony for it, and that would be one type of belief.
So what exactly would we say? Would we say that, I mean, obviously this is an Islam-related show, would we say that we as Muslims have belief, or do we have fact or proof, or what's going on there?
Well, I think we'll come to that, or we'll see what Islam is saying on that. Initially, what we want to do, though, is establish what is the relationship between the two. How far apart is belief and disbelief? When we start talking about creation, we're talking about what's existing around us. But likewise, when we talk about evolution, we're still talking about what exists around us. So what we're really talking about is, how do we believe everything happened? How did it all come about? Because we look around us and we say, okay, we have this. We have mountains, rivers, trees, plants. We have outside of our realm, sun, moon, stars, planets. And then under the microscope, we have molecules, we have atoms. So how did all of this come about? Mm. Did it come about as a part of a plan, a design? Was it, quote-unquote, created? And if so, out of what and how? Then on the other side of the coin, if everything did accidentally come into being just by a lot of floating molecules that bumped into each other, then how we justify that? So nobody's denying existence, except maybe a few people locked away or something, but we're all acknowledging there is existence. So let us say that we believe in that, but how did it get here? This is a conclusion that people will have based on their belief or belief. Because you either believe in evolution or you believe in some type of creationism. You follow that?
Right.
Because if you're saying that creation is a proof, then what would be the proof for it? But if you're saying evolution is a proof, then what's your proof for your evolution? Now, it's clear that they call it the theory of evolution. So without doubt, this is a belief. Even though they will say they're not believers, but they're believing in that.
So, I mean, let's be clear. We're saying it's a distinction between how did life and everything get here. So maybe we should clarify, what do the evolutionists and the Darwinians and so on, what do they say about that?
In the 1960s, there was a big trend to move toward atheism amongst a lot of the people in the Western world. And there was a lot of material published, of which I used to subscribe. I would read everything and anything on the subject of evolution versus creationism. I had a dear friend that was a partner with me in an animal export-import business, animal shows, things that we did. And he was very much one who believed in this evolution. He wrote the book called Ovens of Life. And now, the more we looked into it, the more we discovered things, the less we could see evidence for Christianity. That was our background, and that's what we were trying to make a comparison between. What did Christianity teach, and what did this evolutionary theory teach? And to some extent, it seemed like we were finding proof for evolution over what Christianity called creationism. Yet, at the same time, there were certain dead ends that you would run into. Not being real scientists, not really having laboratories to study things, rather drawing conclusions based on what we read, what lectures you might hear, and so on in those days, it seemed to be that the weight was in favor toward that evolutionary concept, but it had problems.
So what do creationists then say? I mean, how all life began? I mean,
Again, according to Christianity and Judaism, there is creation because the Bible, I mean, this is the foundation for the monotheistic religions of Judaism and Christianity. Then it clearly says in the very first words in the book of Genesis, in the beginning. So this implies a time right away, in the beginning. Okay, where are you going to go from there? And it starts talking about how God, who is God, where did he come from, created the heavens and the earth. And it even says that he created this in a period of time of six yom, periods of time. Yom does not necessarily mean day in the Hebrew language. By the way, yom is also the exact same word in Arabic for the word day or epoch or period of time. And so that we can get out of the way for the viewers right away. It doesn't have to be a 24-hour day.
Right.
Because if you said, well, the sun wasn't created yet, how did you get a 24-hour day? It doesn't mean that.
Doesn't even the Quran say like something to the effect that...
Well, you want to go to the Quran yet. Hold on.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
That's not time.
Right.
We want to just explore what...
What they believe.
Yeah. But what is this belief thing? Because the majority of the people on the earth believe something.
Right.
Some kind of God. Whether they're Buddhists or Hindus, Muslim Jews or Christians. And this is what I'm going to allude to, that the problem comes in when we want to take the Bible in the translation literal, we're running into some difficulties. One is the day thing, which we just solved that one. That was pretty simple to deal with.
Right.
But then it says that in 6 days he created the heavens and the earth, but on the seventh day he rested. Well, now already you got another problem. Okay, you got a God out here that creates everything, but all of a sudden he has a human quality of resting. He got tired. Wow, I wonder if he's still resting now. Did he ever wake up? Did he fall asleep? Is he going to fall asleep again? Is he going to get tired later on? What is he subject to? What are his limitations? So this is one of the first problems that you deal with, is how God is described in the text. Again, we'll say that there's no original for this text. Not existent today. We've talked about that in other programs. The scholars of the Bible, for the Jewish book and the Christian book, have all acknowledged the originals have not existed in centuries upon centuries. Even what we have today is not an accurate copy, even of a copy of a copy. For the benefit of those who don't believe that, don't believe what I just said, I highly encourage them to visit one of the search engines online and just type in the word Bart Arum for themselves and find out the proofs on this subject. But that's beside the point. According to these translations, it seems that this God, or whatever it was, put all this together and then, for some reason, created a human being. All these animals are being created, by the way. Different things. I think light is mentioned first, and then a separation of the darkness and the light, the water and the earth, and so on. We have a lot of mention about creation there. And then it goes on to tell us about the creation of man in another chapter. And man is being created, one, by himself, and then a mate is created for him. And from these two, it seems like a lot of stuff's coming forward. But then all of a sudden, in another chapter, it says, chapter 6 of Genesis, the sons of God saw the daughters of men, found them to be fair, took them to a wife, and went in unto them, and from them came the mighty men of old, these sons of God. And you're going, hold on a second. What's this sons of God stuff?
Right. Well, Sheikha, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll get to my favorite part of the show, where Islam kind of bridges that gap and closes it up. I've been trying to jump to it a little too quick, but inshallah, if God wills, we'll get into that. So don't go anywhere. You're watching Closing the Gap.
Fearing only Allah, devoting our lives for Him.
Reviewing the second rule of Al-Mim As-Sakinah. That is the letter Mim. So if the first Mim is non-vowel or Sakinah, followed by a vowel Mim. So I will merge the first in the letter and I will pronounce them as one. وَآمَنَهُمْ مِنْ. And we spoke abundantly on the virtues of seeking refuge with Allah from the outcast Satan. Especially for the first reciter, he's got to recite it out loud.
وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الْبُرُوجِ.
أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ.
فإذا جاءت الصاخة.
وإذا النفوس زوجت.
Make sure it's ضمة. وإذا النفوس.
Thank you for joining us.
Fearing only Allah, devoting our lives for Him.
Bismillah. Welcome back to Closing the Gap. I'm your host, Omar Dunlap, and of course we have with us Sheikh Yusuf Estes. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Sheikh, just before the break, we were talking about some of the discrepancies between belief and unbelief. We got into talking about evolution versus creation and so on. And we touched on this, and I wanted to ask you something to the effect of there are some discrepancies between the biblical account of creation and what we see in evolution and so on. Now, do you think that atheism is growing according to some statistics? Do you think that that's the result of the biblical story of creation in particular?
I can't really say why people do what they do, but it does seem that there is a big tendency to go toward atheism, especially in some of the countries I've visited, such as Denmark, Sweden, Norway, and even in the Netherlands as well. What I would like to mention, though, is that as we found some discrepancies here in this theory of creation, we can also find some huge discrepancies now in this idea of the theory of evolution.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, let's take a few of those. One of the theories of evolution presented to children early on in school is this picture of a little marmoset becomes a monkey, the monkey becomes sort of an ape, a chimpanzee goes to a gorilla, the gorilla becomes some kind of a knuckle-dragging, looks like your Uncle Charlie, and then finally, you know, you've got this human being walking around with no clothes on.
Mm.
Maybe even carrying a briefcase. Some I've even seen that showing that one. And this is how it's presented, the theory of evolution of a human.
Mm.
Now, there are some other evolutionary ideas that they have as well, that the whole earth at one time was covered with a blue-green algae.
Mm. Mm.
Then along comes some type of amoeboid or something are eating this blue-green algae, but doesn't tell us where either one of the two came from originally.
Mm.
But then in the book itself, it said, and then something had to come along and eat them. Why? And then a bigger item is eating that, and then a larger on that, and a larger, it's that one where you see the bigger mm. fish, and then this huge monster whale. And all along you're thinking, well, how did it come? Well, they said some of these, and this is the theory of the survival of the fittest.
Mm.
Well, the weaker ones were swallowed by the bigger ones. All right?
Mm.
This means they were cannibals.
Mm-hmm.
So if everything is coming from this origin, then everything came from cannibalism.
Mm.
Now that's a heavy one to throw out at the people.
Right.
And even some have tried to assert that there's types of cannibalism within all species. And you're like, wait a minute, hold on. And they can say, well, there were humans that ate humans. That's a true story, but it doesn't mean that that supports your theory.
Mm.
Then we go back to the first part of the program when we talked about this. Some of the other faults that we're going to find with this idea of evolution as being a reality is if you said, well, humans came from monkeys, as we mentioned, they assert that.
Mm.
A five-year-old child looking at this picture and looking up and saying, so humans came from monkeys. Yes, this evolved to this, this evolved to that, that became this, this became that. And that's how it happened, survival of the fittest.
Mm.
Well, if that's true, if humans evolved from monkeys, child statement, question coming up, so why do we still have monkeys?
Right.
How do you explain we still have the gorillas, we still have the apes? Oh, lo, 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 and now we're going to listen to some stories, but the child would say, so are these then humans who haven't yet evolved?
Mm.
And how come we haven't destroyed them?
Mm.
Haven't we done away with the, in other words, if I'm replacing something, how come it's still there?
Right, right. And in terms of creationism, I mean, if we're having, if evolution, what are the, let me rephrase it like this. What are the problems that evolutionists have with creation?
Well, one of the things that immediately becomes the problem for somebody who doesn't want to believe, if you believe in a God, and this is the real reason why I think a lot of people leave religion, whether they're leaving Christianity, Islam, or any religion, is because if you believe in God, then he's the one controlling.
Mm.
And you don't want that. You don't want control in your life. You say, I want to be the controller. The Frank Sinatra song, I did it my way, my way or the highway.
Mm.
And when you put yourself in that position, you become the God.
Mm.
You're the one in control. You're the one saying that how everything's going to happen. And so that is the ultimate to say, I cut myself from all religion. I just want to be in charge of me. I'm the whole thing. I'm everything. But from these people, we find the highest rate of suicide.
Mm,
from the atheists, those who claim that they don't believe in a God, these are the first, fastest, quickest to commit suicide.
Mm. So how does Islam then close that gap between... Well,
very simple. Read the Quran itself, and you'll find that the thing about the God resting, we don't have. We do have Sitta Ayom. Yes, the 6 days are there. But it says, Thumma Astawa ala Arsh. After the completion of the creation, he rose out of the creation and he's there in control of it.
Mm.
Not saying that he's weary or tired. Allah said in the Quran, and he never grows weary of caring for it, taking care of it, and he is mighty and powerful above all things.
Mm-hmm.
So we have the God here who is always in a God position, not in a prone position, mm-hmm. not something that you're going to compare to a human being. Right. That's one. Another, when we talk about the creation, we find that he says that he did create human beings in stages.
Mm-hmm.
This is clear, and this is 1,400 years ago, by the way. But talking about the human being from the conception point of view in embryology, all the embryologists who study this have found that without a doubt, there's no way 1,400 years ago somebody could have known these stages, first of all, you'd have to have microscopes, which they didn't have, and see the actual way that an egg is fertilized and attaches itself to the wall of the womb, and then how it punctures and forms this first creation of a human being. And then Allah says in the Quran, Bismi Rabbika Alladhi Khalaq Khalaqal Insana Min Alaqa. And it's saying that he created human beings from an alaqa, which is exactly the description of what we look like under a microscope, a leech-like clot of blood, clinging, attaching, puncturing, and causing that blood clot. And that's the start of a human being. And that's the very first words that come in the Quran. There are many other proofs as well in geology, in the way that mountains are formed and they go deep down like roots or tent pegs mentioned in the Quran, confirmed today by geologists. The weather phenomenon, when we start talking about where does hail come from, this was not known until very recent years how it works, and yet it's mentioned in the Quran about the ions going up and down through the clouds and causing hail to come down. Another phenomenon talking about where the seas come together but they don't actually blend. This is also mentioned in Quran, and from someone living in a desert and doesn't see any seas, you know.
Right.
And a number of the phenomenon that we find today to be scientific evidence supporting what was in the Quran 1,400 years ago. We don't have time to go through all the things about the Quran or the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, his explanations. But what we find again and again is there's no error. Either it's absolutely confirmed or they haven't confirmed it yet, but nothing they can disprove. Prophecies that he mentioned go way beyond the possibility of accidental prediction. Prophecies that we see happening even in recent years. The fact that the Arabs, who have been poor, impoverished for 1,400 years, suddenly now having this wealth to build these high structures in the deserts, was predicted 1,400 years ago as a sign of the last days. The fact that children would actually enslave their own parents, and we see this happening today. Some of the other things, talking about your extremities would speak to you, your arms speaking to you. How? And we hold cell phones, and even one saying that your waist will inform you of what's going on in your home while you're away. And when you get those text messages, you look down, hold on, I got a message coming in now, you know, that kind of thing.
You don't even have to look down. You can get the little Bluetooth now and just...
There are many things mentioned in these prophecies, predictions, which we're able to confirm today with no doubt. But those people believed without seeing the proof. So that was belief in what? In the way that it came to them. And they saw Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. They understood what he was saying would be absolutely true. So they also accepted the other things he said that they couldn't prove yet. And this is a belief based on proof and conviction.
So is it correct to say then that Islam or Muslims then, their faith is based on proof?
Yes, we have substantial evidence. I recall a classic saying, when I was trying to convert a Muslim to become a Christian, and he was telling me he would do so, provided I would provide him with proof. And I said, my God, man, religion is not about proof. It's about faith. And he said, in Islam, we have faith and proof. I was shocked. And I said, how can you say such a thing? Do you mean to sit there and tell me, as a Muslim, you can prove there's a God? He said, do you mean to sit there and tell me, as a preacher for Christianity, that you can't?
SubhanAllah.
And I've shared this with other pastors and ministers and preachers over the years, and priests, and they've said the same thing. Well, what is the proof? I said, you know what? That's the same thing I said. And we invite folks to watch some of our other programs. We've shown so many proofs from Islam again and again and again. But consider the Quran. But the biggest proof is inside of yourself. That anytime you're willing to clear out this heart, clean it up, and open it up and say, oh God, if you're there, guide me. There's your biggest proof. Because if you're guided, who knew you said that? If you see an evidence pop up in front of you, there's your proof. And it's available 24 hours a day to anybody who wants to try it.
SubhanAllah. Well, Sheikh, we have about 2 minutes left. So if you want, you can give our audience just a final thought.
What I would like to encourage all human beings to consider is this. That, first of all, if you believe something already, then consider it from the standpoint of having the most possible evidence for what you have. Second of all, is if you find something better than what you have, be prepared to move to that. Because if you find more evidence, there's no reason to stay on what you know is not really true anymore. Move to the thing which has the most evidence. And third, give a lot of room for other people to make the same decision. Don't force everybody around you to accept what you believe simply because you are on the mood for that right now. You might change your mind tomorrow.
Right.
Take it easy. Lighten up. We're all in this together. Let's see what we can do to move forward to close the gap.
Inshallah. Well, Sheikh, that's all the time we have for us today. We encourage our viewers to make sure they catch us next time. Until then, I'm your host, Omar Dunlap, wishing you peace. Assalamu alaikum.
Oh, youth, tear upon the core of blasphemy. Follow your prophet and on evil make a victory. Let our righteousness be a role model to our children, making new generations of believers decently upbringing, with parents as an example. As gems we shape them, fearing only Allah, devoting our lives for Him.
Huda TV strives to bring you, our viewers, the best in Islamic programming. Please send your comments and suggestions to feedback@huda.tv.
Fearing only Allah, devoting our lives for Him.
Bismillah. Welcome back to Closing the Gap. I'm your host, Omar Dunlap, and of course we have with us Sheikh Yusuf Estes. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa
rahmatullah. Sheikh, just before the break, we were talking about some of the discrepancies between belief and unbelief. We got into talking about evolution versus creation and so on. And we touched on this, and I wanted to ask you something to the effect of there are some discrepancies between the biblical account of creation and what we see in evolution and so on. Now, do you think that there's atheism is growing according to some statistics? Do you think that that's the result of the biblical story of creation in particular?
I can't really say why people do what they do, but it does seem that there is a big tendency to go toward atheism, especially in some of the countries I've visited, such as Denmark, Sweden, Norway, and even in the Netherlands as well. What I would like to mention, though, is that as we found some discrepancies here in this theory of creation, we can also find some huge discrepancies now in this idea of the theory of evolution. Okay, well, let's take a few of those. One of the theories of evolution presented to children early on in school is this picture of a little marmoset becomes a monkey, the monkey becomes sort of an ape, a chimpanzee goes to a gorilla, the gorilla becomes some kind of a knuckle-dragging, looks like your Uncle Charlie, and then finally, you know, you've got this human being walking around with no clothes on, maybe even carrying a briefcase. Some I've even seen that, showing that one, and this is how it's presented, the theory of evolution of a human. Now, there are some other evolutionary ideas that they have as well, that the whole earth at one time was covered with a blue-green algae. Then along comes some type of amoeboid or something are eating this blue-green algae, but doesn't tell us where either one of the two came from originally. But then in the book itself, it said, and then something had to come along and eat them. Why? And then a bigger item is eating that, and then a larger on that, and a larger, it's that one where you see the bigger fish, fish, and then this huge monster whale. And all along you're thinking, well, how did it come? Well, they said some of these, and this is the theory of the survival of the fittest. Well, the weaker ones were swallowed by the bigger ones. All right? This means they were cannibals. So if everything is coming from this origin, then everything came from cannibalism. Now that's a heavy one to throw out at the people.
Right.
And even some have tried to assert that there's types of cannibalism within all species. And you're like, wait a minute, hold on. And they can say, well, there were humans that ate humans. That's a true story, but it doesn't mean that that supports your theory. Then we go back to the first part of the program when we talked about this. Some of the other faults that we're going to find with this idea of evolution as being a reality is if you said, well, humans came from monkeys, as we mentioned, they assert that. A five-year-old child looking at this picture and looking up and saying, so humans came from monkeys. Yes, this evolved to this, this evolved to that, that became this, this became that. And that's how it happened, survival of the fittest. Well, if that's true, if humans evolved from monkeys, child statement, question coming up, so why do we still have monkeys?
Right.
How do you explain we still have the gorillas, we still have the apes? Oh, lo, 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 and now we're going to listen to some stories, but the child would say, so are these then humans who haven't yet evolved? And how come we haven't destroyed them? Haven't we done away with the, in other words, if I'm replacing something, how come it's still there?
Right, right. And in terms of creationism, I mean, if we're having, if evolution, what are the, let me rephrase it like this. What are the problems that evolutionists have with creation?
Well, one of the things that immediately becomes the problem for somebody who doesn't want to believe, if you believe in a God, and this is the real reason why I think a lot of people leave religion, whether they're leaving Christianity, Islam, or any religion, is because if you believe in God, then he's the one controlling. And you don't want that. You don't want control in your life. You say, I want to be the controller. The Frank Sinatra's song, I did it my way. My way or the highway. And when you put yourself in that position, you become the God. You're the one in control. You're the one saying that how everything's going to happen. And so that is the ultimate to say, I cut myself from all religion. I just want to be in charge of me. I'm the whole thing. I'm everything. But from these people, we find the highest rate of suicide. From the atheists, those who claim that they don't believe in a God, these are the first, fastest, quickest to commit suicide.
So how does Islam then close that gap between...
Well, very simple. Read the Quran itself, and you'll find that the thing about the God resting, we don't have. We do have Sitta Ayyum. Yes, the 6 days are there. But it says, Thumma Astawal ala Arsh. After the completion of the creation, he rose out of the creation and he's there in control of it. Not saying that he's weary or tired. Wala ya'uduhu hifdhuhuma wa huwa al-'aliyyul 'azhim, Allah said in the Quran, and he never grows weary of caring for it, taking care of it, and he is mighty and powerful above all things. So we have the God here who is always in a God position, not in a prone position, not something that you're going to compare to a human being. That's one. Another, when we talk about the creation, we find that he says that he did create human beings in stages. This is clear, and this is 1400 years ago, by the way. But talking about the human being from the conception point of view in embryology, all the embryologists who study this have found that without a doubt, there's no way 1400 years ago somebody could have known these stages, this, because it, first of all, you'd have to have microscopes, which they didn't have, and see the actual way that an egg is fertilized and attaches itself to the wall of the womb, and then how it punctures and forms this first creation of a human being. And then Allah says in the Quran, Bismi Rabbika Alladhi Khalaq Khalaqal Insana Min Alaqa. And is saying that he created human beings from an alaqa, which is exactly the description of what we look like under a microscope, a leech-like clot of blood, clinging, attaching, puncturing, and causing that blood clot. And that's the start of a human being. And that's the very first words that come in the Quran. There are many other proofs as well in geology, in the way that mountains are formed, and they go deep down like roots or tent pegs mentioned in the Quran. confirmed today by geologists. Mm. The weather phenomenon, when we start talking about where does hail come from, this was not known until very recent years how it works, and yet it's mentioned in the Quran about the ions going up and down through the clouds and causing hail to come down. Mm. Another phenomenon talking about where the seas come together, but they don't actually blend. This is also mentioned in Quran from someone living in a desert and doesn't see any seas, you know.
Right.
And a number of the phenomena that we find today to be scientific evidence supporting what was in the Quran 1,400 years ago.
Mm.
We don't have time to go through all the things about the Quran
right.
or the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, his explanations. But what we find again and again is there's no error.
Mm.
Either it's absolutely confirmed or they haven't confirmed it yet, but nothing they can disprove. Prophecies that he mentioned go way beyond the possibility of accidental prediction.
Mm.
Prophecies that we see happening even in recent years. The fact that the Arabs, who have been poor, impoverished for 1,400 years, suddenly now having this wealth to build these high structures in the deserts, was predicted 1,400 years ago as a sign of the last days.
Mm.
The fact that children would actually enslave their own parents,
mm.
and we see this happening today.
Mm.
Some of the other things, talking about your extremities would speak to you, your arms speaking to you. How? And we hold cell phones.
Mm.
And even one saying that your waist will inform you of what's going on in your home while you're away.
Mm.
And when you get those text messages, you look down, hold on, I got a message coming in now, you know,
right.
that kind of thing.
You don't even have to look down. You can get the little Bluetooth now and just...
There are many things mentioned in these prophecies, predictions, which we're able to confirm today with no doubt. But those people believed without seeing the proof.
Mm.
So that was belief in what? In the way that it came to them. And they saw Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. They understood what he was saying would be absolutely true. So they also accepted the other things he said that they couldn't prove yet.
Mm.
And this is a belief based on proof and conviction.
Mm. So is it correct to say then that Islam or Muslims then, their faith is based on proof?
Yes, we have substantial evidence. I recall a classic saying, when I was trying to convert a Muslim to become a Christian,
mm.
and he was telling me he would do so, provided I would provide him with proof.
Mm.
And I said, my God, man, religion is not about proof.
Mm.
It's about faith.
Mm.
And he said, in Islam, we have faith and proof. I was shocked. And I said, how can you say such a thing? Do you mean to sit there and tell me, as a Muslim, you can prove there's a God? He said, do you mean to sit there and tell me, as a preacher for Christianity, that you can't?
Mm. It's Pahala.
And I've shared this with other pastors and ministers and preachers over the years, and priests. And they've said the same thing. Well, what is the proof? I said, you know what? That's the same thing I said.
Mm.
And we invite folks to watch some of our other programs. We've shown so many proofs from Islam again and again and again. But consider the Quran.
Mm.
But the biggest proof is inside of yourself.
Mm.
That anytime you're willing to clear out this heart, clean it up, and open it up and say, oh God, if you're there, guide me. There's your biggest proof.
Mm.
Because if you're guided, who knew you said that? If you see an evidence pop up in front of you, there's your proof. And it's available 24 hours a day to anybody who wants to try it.
Mm. Well, Sheikh, we have about 2 minutes left. So if you want, you can give our audience just a final thought.
What I would like to encourage all human beings to consider is this. That, first of all, if you believe something already, then consider it from the standpoint of having the most possible evidence for what you have. Second of all, is if you find something better than what you have, be prepared to move to that.
Mm.
Because if you find more evidence, there's no reason to stay on what you know is not really true anymore. Move to the thing which has the most evidence.
Mm.
And third, give a lot of room for other people to make the same decision. Don't force everybody around you to accept what you believe simply because you are on the mood for that right now. You might change your mind tomorrow.
Right.
Take it easy. Lighten up. We're all in this together. Let's see what we can do to move forward to close the gap.
Inshallah. Well, Sheikh, that's all the time we have for us today. We encourage our viewers to make sure they catch us next time. Until then, I'm your host, Omar Dunlap, wishing you peace. Assalamu alaikum.
Oh, you tear apart the core of blasphemy. follow your prophet, and on evil make a victory. Let our righteousness be a role model to our children, making new generations of believers decently upbringing, with parents as an example. As gems we shape them, fearing only Allah, devoting our lives for Him.